Hey everyone, welcome back to Chip Stock Investor. We're going to be talking about how to invest in chip stocks in 2025. This is actually part two. We're going to be focusing on a foundational part of the industry, EDA software. If you haven't caught the first part of this series, go ahead and check it out. We'll link it right here in the video. Let's go ahead and launch right into this. These are our key points to watch out for in this video. EDA is foundational to chips, and therefore it's foundational to the modern economy. Second, what is EDA exactly? Is it software? Is it hardware? No, actually it's EDA. EDA also has a very unique R&D based business cycle, which we'll discuss later in the episode. And finally, look out for what EDA software stocks there are. Are any of them a buy, and what are chip stock investors' top holdings in 2025?
For starters, let us show you where EDA software businesses fall into our semiconductor industry flow. You can see there at the top, along with IP and patents. Keep a lookout for that IP and patents video that should be out in another week or two. But EDA, along with IP and patents, are foundational to the industry. Compared to semiconductor end market sales, which should be $600 to $700 billion in 2025, EDA software sales expected to be about $15 billion in 2025, roughly a mid-teens percentage year-over-year increase over 2024. That is a very small piece of the industry, but as Casey said, this is foundational. EDA is absolutely necessary for everything that happens after it in the semiconductor industry flow. And without EDA, none of these other markets would be possible. Embedded software, foundry or semiconductor manufacturing, and then of course, end market semiconductor sales themselves and the electronic systems that are built with those semiconductors, expected to be north of $2 trillion market in 2025. So this leads us to the big question then. Casey, what exactly is EDA software? What is an EDA platform?
Electronic design automation, or EDA, has become absolutely fundamental to chip design because chips have become increasingly complex. Now there's billions of features on the most advanced of chips, some of them just nanometers thick or tens of atoms in dimension. So it's impossible to draw this out by hand. You have to have a software assist you in creating these designs. EDA software automatically places millions of microscopic circuitry patterns into a chip design. You can think of these patterns as pre-designed rooms, maybe in a large high-rise building. Those rooms, once they're pre-designed, they get replicated and dropped into the total building design rather than each individual room being drafted or designed by hand.
Yeah, that's right. That's where the word automation and electronic design automation comes from in the EDA acronym. But it's not just the core software anymore. It's actually also hardware, which is why we call these businesses EDA platforms. So in addition to the software design suites, EDA also oftentimes uses special chips like an FPGA for the emulation and verification of a design before it goes to the manufacturing floor. EDA software also integrates with the manufacturing equipment itself on the manufacturing floor to make sure that what was engineered and designed is accurately transposed onto the silicon wafer before it's diced up into chips. And then when building very complex computing systems, like let's say servers that go into a data center, EDA companies are also increasingly selling their services to those businesses that design and operate the data centers. So they also integrate with the actual tech equipment and devices themselves. EDA companies also have their own extensive libraries of IP and patents that they license to their customers. So if we go back to our semiconductor industry flow here, you can see EDA is kind of located in this small little bubble at the top of the supply chain. However, EDA actually does find its way into every single step of the manufacturing and design process. So that's why we call these EDA platform businesses.
Before we talk about who the biggest players and competitors are in the EDA portion of the industry, I want to remind you of our membership with Semiconductor Insider. Our Semiconductor Insider membership gets you access to video notes for this video and all of our videos, giving you a more well-rounded view of the industry.
Semi Insider is also the home of all of our research. So if you're interested in getting a look at all of that, as well as the most up-to-date information on what we're doing with our portfolio and comparing that against our community of like-minded investors, check it out. Semi Insider, just 10 bucks a month.
You can find the link to our membership in our description below. It's on our Ko-fi page. You can check that out there. You'll often hear us say that EDA is an oligopoly, meaning that the industry is largely controlled by just a small handful of businesses. A lot of consolidation has happened, and so these EDA businesses have been reduced into just a few powerful platform businesses that span software and related hardware. In this case, there's three main players: Synopsys, Cadence Design Systems, and Siemens, which bought Mentor Graphics.
Yeah, let's just take a moment here and talk about the biggest company among the EDA oligopoly, Synopsys. And this leads us to an important point. This could be the biggest and most important merger of 2025. Actually, just over a year ago, as of this recording, Synopsys announced that it was going to be acquiring Ansys, which is a physics simulation engine. In this slide, Synopsys has been talking about for the better part of a year as they work on the regulatory requirements to finish the takeover of Ansys. Besides leading to a much bigger industry titan, Synopsys combining with Ansys should lead to better profit margins and better long-term earnings per share growth once this is finished. Synopsys continues to say that they should have this finished before the first half of 2025 is over. But due to the size of this deal, there are some regulatory hurdles. So Synopsys and Ansys have already agreed that pending completion of the deal, they will be divesting a couple of small segments to Keysight Technologies. Keysight has also been acquiring and building out its own EDA tools, especially for the communications and networking industry and radio frequency or RF chip design. So a couple of segments, optics and Ansys's power artist business, will be going to Keysight once Synopsys and Ansys have completed their merger.
Cadence Design Systems is the number two in the EDA market. Cadence has also been making some moves in physics simulation. They made an acquisition of Beta CAE Systems in 2024 for about $1.24 billion. Beta CAE is Cadence's response to Synopsys' acquisition of Ansys. Because Cadence has made several smaller acquisitions, it appears to be trading for a higher valuation metric than Synopsys, higher price to earnings and price to free cash flow. But if and when Synopsys completes the deal for Ansys, its valuation will become distortedly higher as well. We're going to address that in the second key point regarding the EDA business cycle. But before we discuss that, let's talk about the third biggest company in the EDA space, Siemens.
Yeah, Siemens EDA, formerly Mentor Graphics. This is not in our personal portfolio. Siemens is an industrial giant in Europe. And so the EDA portion of their business is very small. By no means is it a pure play or anything approaching that in the EDA market. That said, it is worth mentioning that Siemens is also getting in on this merger and acquisition spree, specifically addressing things like physics simulation. They announced in October 2024 that they will be acquiring Altair Engineering, or ticker symbol ALTR, for approximately 10 billion euro. This is also going to have some regulatory hurdles because of again, size of this acquisition. But all of this demonstrates the point that all three companies in this EDA oligopoly, Synopsys, Cadence, and Siemens EDA, are looking at this convergence between semiconductor engineering and manufacturing and more mechanical engineering and manufacturing. So Siemens getting in this battle as well, even though we don't call it an EDA pure play, absolutely very much worth mentioning and keeping track of if this is a sub-industry in semiconductors that you're interested in.
There's a number of smaller players in the EDA space, or maybe even ancillary plays from companies like AMD, perhaps. We won't be discussing all of those companies on this video. If you want more in-depth information on them, check out our video notes via that Semiconductor Insider membership. But let's talk about how AI is affecting EDA. And what's a discussion about AI if we don't mention NVIDIA?
Yeah, that's right. And when we're talking about AI and NVIDIA, of course, NVIDIA is lending a very large helping hand to advances in the EDA market right now. At NVIDIA's annual GTC in March of 2024, there were several co-announcements made with none other than Synopsys about how Synopsys is using NVIDIA's hardware and different software libraries throughout its EDA platform. You can see that depicted here. This just, I think, talks about the strength of NVIDIA right now, how they have been able to proliferate their products and services throughout the semiconductor supply chain and beyond into the actual end markets themselves. A little picture of a car there, of course, NVIDIA hardware also making its way into actual end devices. And as far as the integration between EDA platforms and the actual manufacturing process itself, it's now been a couple of years that Synopsys, ASML, and Taiwan Semiconductor Manufacturing have been using NVIDIA's cuLitho software library to help speed up the production process, specifically, of course, with lithography equipment. But it's not just NVIDIA that's using AI in its chip design work. Google, or Alphabet, has also been making some moves in this department as well.
Google has been getting a lot of buzz. Recently, the quantum AI portion of Google released some information about their Willow chip. But what we're going to focus on is their breakthrough with Alpha chip. Google's Alpha chip is speeding up the design of Google's custom TPU, or Tensor Processing Unit. Now, Google doesn't seem to be trying to disrupt EDA currently, but rather it's going to open up its machine learning breakthroughs for use by chip designers and EDA developers like Synopsys and Cadence Design. It's time to talk about key point number two. And you may be thinking that since EDA software platform businesses are foundational, they may not have the same cyclicality as a semiconductor business, but rather it is a unique R&D-based business cycle. Let's talk about that.
Yeah, that's absolutely right. So the EDA core of these businesses are software. And so much of that revenue is tied to subscriptions and licenses. Usually these are multi-year contracts. So that's why you'll see in the next following slides we show you, the revenue itself is quite steady up and to the right, like you would expect from a software business. However, because so much of these businesses, especially Synopsys, and to a slightly lesser extent, Cadence Design, they also have that IP licensing, the patents and the IP that they often pair with their software for their customers to use. And then they also sell hardware like FPGA-based chips for emulation and verification. There is this lumpier revenue element to the business, and it also leads to some bigger swings in things like free cash flow, profit margins for companies like Synopsys and Cadence. Casey, let's first talk about the revenue though, before we talk about that cyclicality and profits. Synopsys and Cadence, their revenue tends to follow the pace of semiconductor industry research and development spending, right?
We'll show you a couple charts, first from Intel and then from Micron. For Intel, you can see a revenue increase and decline with the cyclicality of the semiconductor industry and end markets. But their R&D expense, interestingly, doesn't really follow the same pattern. You can see that it actually just basically increases each year. And with Micron, an even more cyclical business in regards to revenue, they still have the same trend line when it comes to R&D expenses. Compare that to Synopsys and Cadence revenue over the last 20 years. You can see that their total revenue lines follow the R&D lines of companies like Micron and Intel up and to the right. Not a lot of cyclicality in their revenue. But where does the cyclicality come in for companies like Synopsys and Cadence?
You tend to see the cyclicality show up in metrics like free cash flow profitability. Here's a look at Synopsys first, their free cash flow cycles. You can see the dips that roughly align with the semiconductor industry sales cycle. When overall semiconductor industry sales are up, Synopsys' revenue is also up. But when there are down cycles for the semiconductor industry overall, Synopsys' free cash flow tends to decline. And the stock price tends to roughly correlate with this free cash flow cycle as well. And of course, a very similar story with Cadence. There has been historically a bit less cyclicality with Cadence's free cash flow, at least up until this most recent year. But you can see more pronounced growth for free cash flow when the semiconductor industry is firing on all cylinders, and slower free cash flow growth in the down years. And again, much like Synopsys, Cadence's stock price has tended to follow the cyclicality of this free cash flow generation. And again, this all goes back to the fact that Synopsys and Cadence aren't just software companies. They are platform businesses. They offer the software, they offer the patents and IP licensing, and they offer hardware like via an FPGA for emulation and verification. These are really unique businesses.
Let's round out this discussion by talking about EDA software stocks. Are any of them a buy? And what are our top holdings in 2025? You're looking at Chipstock Investors' top seven holdings. Number five, you can see, is Synopsys and Cadence Design Systems. We kind of view that as one position in our portfolio.
And after taking a break from a dollar cost average plan on Synopsys and Cadence this past year, because of the cyclicality of the industry, a lot of semiconductor industry sales have been down starting in late 2023 and through 2024. Synopsys and Cadence stocks have struggled. But at this point, we see some upside again as a new growth cycle emerges, especially for a lot of the customers for EDA platforms like automotive and industrial and power chips. We think we could see a rise higher in free cash flow margins for Synopsys and Cadence, and think these are a decent DCA candidate. So we're looking at nibbling on these two stocks once again throughout the course of 2025. And in addition to that, Casey, I think our top picks are NVIDIA, of course, our number one overall holding, as well as Google stock. Now, NVIDIA and Google aren't EDA businesses themselves, but the strength and power of those businesses, they are most definitely lending their technology to the EDA industry and have some potential things going on in the future where they, you know, at least we foresee they could end up doing something in the EDA space more directly. So NVIDIA and Google, along with Synopsys and Cadence Design, are our four picks for the EDA market in 2025.
Thanks, everybody, for watching this episode of Chipstock Investor. Coming soon will be part three of this series regarding IP and patents. Make sure you've hit the subscribe button, have notifications enabled so you don't miss that. And once again, check out Semiconductor Insider monthly membership via Ko-fi. Link in the description below gets you access to all kinds of cool stuff, including the show notes for this video and a much more expanded discussion over on Discord. Take care, everybody. We'll see you again soon at Chipstock Investor.
Testing. Testing.
Testing. Testing.
What is happening?
It's just been a morning.